And we're pleased to welcome to our studios Jonah Lehrer. He is the author most recently of Imagine, How Creativity Works, and we're happy to welcome you to TVO.
Thank you for having me on.
Let's just start with a basic definition. Creativity, how are you defining it?
You know, we could spend the rest of the show just parsing the exact details of how one might define creativity. My definition is pretty minimal. I define it as a new idea that has a second life. So it's a new idea that someone else finds useful or beautiful, that finds a niche in the world, a spot. And that's why it sticks around. So it's a new idea. And when you look at those new ideas, they're often just a new connection between old ideas. That's the definition I endorse.
That's your definition. Is that different from the so-called traditional definition that people have sort of used for the last many centuries?
There have been a lot of myths for a long time around creativity. And those myths include everything from this notion that creativity is a very rare gift, that it's reserved for the lucky few. The vast majority of us are simply confined to repeating the work of others. And you see this myth mirrored in these very sad surveys of school kids. So you ask a second grader, are you creative? And 95% say, yes, I love to paint, I love to draw, I love to write short stories. By fifth grade, that's down to about 50%. By the time kids are high school seniors, upwards of 90% say, I'm not creative. I'm not a creative type.
That's sad.
Oh, It's so sad. It's tragic. It suggests that our schooling systems are very efficient at killing creativity off. That we indoctrinate kids in this myth that creativity is somehow very, very rare. When the science says the opposite, the science suggests that creativity is a universal feature of human nature. It's something we all have. It doesn't mean we're all equally good at it, like any other talent. It's unevenly distributed. But it does mean that we can all get better at it. We can all learn to imagine more.
You tell us the science tells us that.
Yes.
How long has the science been telling us that?
It's an interesting question. So I think the science has been pretty convincing that creativity is universal and not this rare, rare thing, probably for the last 30, 40, 50 years.
Not that long.
Really, I think the first studies that really found this were studies of young kids. There's a wonderful Picasso quote that every child is born an artist, the problems begin when we grow up. And the science has really confirmed that.
The science around creativity, brain scans, for example.
Yeah.
That's sort of newer than 50 years ago, though, right?
Yeah.
We're presumably getting a better handle on creativity just over the last decade, I would think.
Absolutely. So for a long time, we've been forced to understand creativity and the imagination from the outside. And this is a very intimidating sort of question to ask, which is why, you know, some reviews estimate that less than 1% of all psychology papers published since World War II have been on the subject of creativity. So here's this defining feature of human nature, and we really didn't understand it. And I think that's where neuroscience, the study of the brain, these 3 pounds of meat inside the head, can really be helpful. Thanks to tools like fMRI, like brain scans, like EEG.
fMRI.
So that's where you put someone in it feels like a noisy coffin, superconducting magnets whirring overhead. It's very noisy and a little claustrophobic. But that allows scientists to use changes in blood flow to understand what's actually happening inside the brain. And so then they can give, for instance, subjects various creative puzzles and see what happens inside your head when you have a moment of insight, when you have one of those epiphanies. You can begin to deconstruct that.
During the course of our conversation, we're going to go through some of the examples you talk about, but the one I want to start with here is not an example that I would have thought represented creativity, but you say it does. I've always just thought it was an incredibly annoying commercial. The Swiffer. You say that was kind of a eureka moment of creativity. How so?
Yeah. Well, the story begins in the early 1990s when Procter & Gamble, the consumer products powerhouse, has assigned upwards of 30 chemists to come up with a new line of soaps for their mops. And so they want to come up with a stronger soap. But this turns out to be a very difficult chemistry problem because you can make a soap stronger, but it tends to peel the varnish off wood floors. It irritates delicate skin. So after a couple years of expensive failures, Procter & Gamble decides to outsource this problem to a design firm called Continuum. The designers at Continuum realized they're not going to know more about the chemistry of soap than the chemists at Procter & Gamble. So they decided to spend 9 months watching people mop the floors.
And they did.
And I've seen this footage. I can assure you it's even more boring than you imagine. But what they discovered after watching people mop the floors for 9 months is that mopping is a terrible idea. That people spend more time cleaning their cleaning tool, cleaning the actual mop, than they do cleaning the actual floor. And this gets back to the fact that over the years, companies like Procter & Gamble had come up with all sorts of mop fibers that were great at getting dirt off the floor, but that made it very tough to get the dirt out of the mop head. And so you watch these videos of these poor people in these small bathtubs splashing around their filthy water, trying in vain to clean their mop, but they can't. So then the floor doesn't even get clean. So after 9 months, the guys at Continuum go back to Procter & Gamble and say, you know, we haven't solved your problem. We just realized it's even worse than you think. That you don't simply need a new line of soap. You need to reinvent the mop. But they didn't know what that reinvention would look like. So on one of their last house visits, they watch an elderly lady clean up some coffee grinds that she'd spilled on her linoleum floor in the kitchen. And even though she said she'd always used her vacuum and loved her mop, that's not how she cleaned up these coffee grinds. Said she tore off a paper towel, wet the paper towel, and ran that paper towel along the floor.
And when the guy saw that?
And when the guy saw that, that's where the Swiffer came
from.
That
was the eureka moment.
That even though they'd all done that themselves, you know, countless times before, watching someone else do it, once they, in a sense, realized what their actual problem was, that triggered the epiphany, that triggered the big breakthrough. And that's what the Swiffer is. It's essentially the pole of a mop with a disposable wipe on the end. It's also a very lucrative product because you can charge $10 for basically six paper towels.
And that's creativity.
That is creativity. That's a new idea like any other. I think one of the dangerous myths we've had for a long time is that we've turned creativity into this very rare, intimidating, esoteric thing. That, you know, you have to be the kind of poet who can just invent ideas out of thin air. Creativity is all around us. Creativity is really just a new connection between old ideas. And sometimes it's going to lead to the Swiffer, sometimes it's going to lead to a new poem or a new kind of movie or a new patent filing, but it's not nearly as rare as we've long assumed.
So what does that story about the Swiffer tell us about the process by which creativity makes itself apparent?
The larger story here is that creativity isn't a single thing. That creativity isn't a single way of thinking that we should always be pursuing. There is no one creativity module inside the human cortex. Instead, creativity is really a catch-all term for a variety of distinct thought processes. That first, those designers at Continuum had to spend 9 months just watching people mop the floor. They had to pretend that they were anthropologists from Mars, as they put it. And that was an essential part of the process. It wasn't fun. It nearly drove them crazy, but it was essential. And then at a certain point, they needed to have one of these moments of insight, one of these blinding revelations that come when you least expect it. And that's a different kind of creativity, and sure enough, it's served by a different kind of process inside the brain. So what we can see is that creativity, although we've long pretended it's a single thing, it's actually a variety of different ways of thinking, each of which is well suited to particular kinds of problems. So the real trick for being a creative person is to make sure you're thinking in the right way at the right time.
Let's do an example that's a little more fun this time. The example that Bruce Springsteen said changed his life when he heard the Bob Dylan song Like a Rolling Stone on the radio. Bob Dylan, well, rather than me do it, why don't you tell it? You tell the story of how Bob Dylan came up with that.
Well, this story takes place in May 1965, and it's been a grueling few months for Dylan. Been in this nonstop performance schedule, and after the last shows in the UK, after the last shows in London, he tells his manager, I'm done with this. I'm sick of strumming my guitar in the spotlight all by myself. I'm sick of the singing and the songwriting. I'm quitting the music business.
And the stupid questions from journalists, the whole thing.
Exactly. He just couldn't take it anymore. So, sure enough, he wasn't bluffing. He returned to New York City, took his Triumph motorcycle straight out of the village, went to this rural cabin in Woodstock, New York. Didn't even bring his guitar. He's determined to write a novel and paint. But after a couple days in Woodstock, he feels this familiar feeling, what he calls the itch of unwritten words. And that's when he does the only thing he knows how to do. He gets out a pencil and a pad of paper and he starts to scribble. Once he begins scribbling, his hand doesn't stop moving for the next several hours. And even though he doesn't know what he's writing down, he describes it as just, it's like vomiting. The associations just come pouring out of him. He can't begin to hold them back. He scrolls for 25 pages, and within those 25 pages are the lyrics to Like a Rolling Stone. And as soon as he commits those words to paper, he knows this is it. He knows this is the song he's been trying to write. So the very next week, he takes the sheaf of lyrics in the cramped space of Studio A, Columbia Records in New York City, and on the fourth take, they record Like a Rolling Stone.
The suggestion there is that you have to hit rock bottom before that eureka moment can happen for you. Is that true?
Well, this is something you see again and again in the creative process, whether it's Bob Dylan or the Swiffer, that people typically do run into walls, that they'll work for a long time and they'll feel like they're making progress, they feel like they're making incremental, tangible progress, but then at a certain point, that sense of progress disappears, that they feel like now this problem is impossible, they have no idea what to do next. And that's really your brain telling you, you need a moment of insight. You need one of these epiphanies that arrive out of the blue. Now, what's interesting here is that the science suggests that when you need a moment of insight, when you've hit the wall, you've hit rock bottom, like Bob Dylan in May 1965, that I think most people assume the way to react is to drink another cup of coffee, to stay late at the office, to do whatever it is we need to do to stay focused on the problem. That's how we'll solve it.
Exactly the opposite thing you should do.
That's exactly backwards. that you will be focused, but you'll be focused on the problem and probably a wrong answer you just can't get past. Instead, what you should do is focus on not being focused. You should take a walk, play some ping pong, take a long, relaxing shower, do whatever it is you need to do to stop thinking about the question. That's when the answer will arrive. There's this wonderful line of Einstein's that creativity is the residue of wasted time. When you need a moment of insight, you have to make time to waste time.
You know why that works?
You know, one theory is, and this is the leading theory by the scientists, is that when we're focused on the problem, when we've just, you know, drunk all that caffeine, our attention's out here, it's out in the world, so we are consumed by the problem. It's not until we're in the shower and we're shampooing our hair that at long last we're able to turn the spotlight of attention inwards. And that's when we hear this quiet voice coming from the back of our head, probably a brain area called the anterior superior temporal gyrus in the back of the right hemisphere, which is trying to give us the answer. Maybe that voice has been there for days or weeks or months. We just haven't taken a moment to listen. That's why it's so important to let yourself listen.
The popular assumption is that Silicon Valley kind of invented this idea of get away from your work, play some pool, play some, you know, shoot some baskets or something like that. But this notion of kind of 15% of do whatever the hell you want time goes way back, decades ago, right?
Yeah, decades ago. It was actually pioneered by a company called 3M, best known for scotch tape and post-it notes and office supply. And when they began proposing the 15% rule, which is they give every researcher 15% of their day to do whatever the hell they want, people said, you're crazy. They're just going to waste time. They're just going to go play ping pong all day long. And that's kind of the point, that the goal of 3M, I think the reason they've got this amazing track record of success, they've been in the innovation business for 60 plus years, they've got 55,000 employees and 55,000 products, is because they want to give their employees what they call attentional freedom. They don't want to micromanage their mind. So if you're working on a problem and you need to take a nap in the corner, there are napping couches. You need to take a walk across their campus in St. Paul, take a walk. You need to play some ping pong to take a break. Do whatever it is you need to do to put your mind at ease, because that is when the answer is most likely to arrive.
Having said that, persistence is a part of the equation, right?
Yes. No, it would be wonderful if relaxation was the universal cure for creativity, if, you know, if it was all about going on vacation. But, you know, you have those moments of inspiration, but they require persistence. You need to get the ideas inside your head so that you can later connect them. And you know, when you talk to people in the creative business, they'll often begin by telling you these romantic stories of the breakthrough in the shower. Then if you press them, they'll talk about all the hard work that came before and after. That even after they had their epiphany, they still had to go through edit after edit, revision after revision. It was never easy.
Let's talk about drugs, shall we? Because every rock and roller, you know, the assumption is that they did some kind of illegal drug and that's what gave them their inspiration to do X, Y, and Z. But we don't have to just keep it that modern. The fact is, you talk about W.H. Auden, the poet in this book, who was scarfing down bennies from the get-go, and that unlocks some of his creativity. How so?
There is this tangled history between, you know, writers and amphetamines. So whether it's W.H. Auden taking benzedrine, an amphetamine that was legal in the 1950s, it was commonly prescribed for asthma, or Jack Kerouac taking benzedrine, or Philip K. Dick. You see again and again these stories of these writers who are relying on these tools as a sort of chemical shortcut. And of course, we should be very, very clear that amphetamines come with all sorts of terrible side effects. They're incredibly addictive and, you know, wreck your body. They make it impossible to sleep. So one definitely would not want to recommend benzes for daily use. There's a reason these drugs are legal now.
Unless you wanted to write 15 novels in 6 years.
Yes, like Philip K. Dick. But even then, you know, he did not live a very long, happy life. But, you know, the reason I focused on Auden is because there's this fascinating moment in his career, these 3 years, where he writes many of his most anthologized poems. So September 1st, 1939, Memory of Yeats, and so on. And he goes on to write many other wonderful poems. I'm a big fan of his late poetry, which is much looser and more relaxed and more full of ambiguity. But in this one period where he is taking benzedrine every single day, his poems are more transparent, they're more precise, they are more clear, and I think that returns us to the effect of benzedrine on the creative process. That these amphetamines, they in a sense sharpen the spotlight of attention. They make it, they turn the wattage up. So for the first time in Auden's career, it was possible for him to spend 12 hours a day thinking about a single line of poetry, or a single metaphor, or a single word. That he said these drugs turned him into a poetry machine. You know, normally our attention is fickle and flits about, we are so distractible. And yet these drugs, especially for writers, make it easier to focus, to stick with the edit until it's perfect.
You want to give some examples of the rock and roller on cocaine who saw it all before his eyes after taking that drug?
Oh, Are we talking here about Keith Richards? Or
probably.
Yeah, no, I mean, Keith Richards is the first one that comes to mind. I tell this wonderful story. I don't know if Keith was actually on cocaine at this point, but he tells this great story about falling asleep in his bed with a guitar and a tape recorder. And he passes out in his bed with a guitar and tape recorder, so we can all imagine why exactly he passed out. But he wakes up at some point in the night, and this is in his memoir, in his autobiography, wakes up at some point in the night, and he just picks up his guitar, turns in the tape recorder, because he, in the midst of his dream, has this wonderful tune he needs to get out. And so he plays some bars, plays some chords, and then he passes out again. He wakes up in the morning, and he remembers that he'd had some great epiphany in the middle of the night. And so he presses play, and there are the chords to "I Can't Get No Satisfaction," followed by 40 minutes of snoring. But that thing really gives us insight less into Keith Richards' drug habits and more into what happens when we fall asleep every night, which is that although we think our brain is off, it's actually searching for new connections, trying to find new associations, new useful ideas.
And coffee wouldn't get it done, I guess, eh?
Coffee works for me. Coffee is my drug of choice. I am very addicted to caffeine, but sometimes you need more. I mean, the reason I think creative people have always been searching for these chemical shortcuts, whether it's writers and benzedrine or, jazz musicians and alcohol, is that creativity is really, really hard. They're always looking for anything that make it just a little bit easier. And I think in recent years, scientists have actually shown that a lot of these drugs, a lot of these compounds, many of which are legal, can actually lead to big boosts in creative production. So just last month, a study showed that when you get undergraduates too drunk to drive, so not a little tipsy, but very, very drunk, they actually solve 30% more of these very difficult creative problems. And that's because when you're drunk, you are more relaxed, you're more at ease, you're more likely to daydream, and daydreaming is a very useful mental state. That's why people who daydream more score much higher on tests of creativity. And so for all these reasons, alcohol, in certain contexts, can be useful, can allow us to solve more problems.
Well, it does open up possibilities that otherwise wouldn't be open. The two girls who are born of the same mother and father on the same day,
yeah,
in the same year.
Yeah.
But they are not twins.
Yeah.
Explain. And I gather, the more stoned you are or the more drunk you are, the more likely you are to figure that out,
yeah,
which I could not figure,
yeah,
out.
Yeah.
Because I read your book free of all of those things.
You don't obviously always want to be drunk or stoned. You don't want to take a math test in that kind of mind or drive a car. But when you're solving those kinds of problems, it helps to know that, they are triplets. That's going to make you more likely to find the answer.
I was wondering whether you're going to give away the answer and make people buy the book together.
I couldn't leave them hanging. That would drive me crazy.
Good enough. How about this one? Let's talk about Yo-Yo Ma and his, you watch that man perform on,
yeah,
the cello, and he has an ability to just kind of let go.
Yeah.
How essential is that ability to quote-unquote let go, yeah, to find your inner creative self?
I mean, that's what fascinated me about Yo-Yo and why I wanted to talk to him is here's this guy playing these incredibly intricate works of music, and yet he's able to, in the moment, and you can see in the looseness of his body, let himself go and focus not on playing it perfectly, but really on expressing the emotion that needs to be expressed. And that's what I wanted to talk to him about, and he tells this wonderful story about how before he steps out on stage, one of the last thoughts he always thinks is about Julia Child. And at first I was like, Julia Child, why are you thinking about a French chef before you walk out on stage? But he says, he always thinks of the time Julia Child dropped the roast chicken. And he says, how did she react to that? Did she scream in horror? He says, no, she dropped the roast chicken, smile never left her face, she picked up the chicken, dusted it off, and then went on with the show. And he says, you have to be in that state of mind. You have to welcome that first mistake because now you are free. Now you can focus on what really matters. And this ability to let yourself go, I think, is an important part of spontaneous creativity. People who create on demand. So that jazz pianist who can walk out on stage and improvise beautiful melodies for 60 minutes, or that stand-up comic, or the improv troupe. These are all creative acts that require us to, in a sense, turn off that voice, always telling us, don't do that, don't do that. And sure enough, you can see this in brain scanners. So what scientists have done is they put jazz pianists inside these fMRI machines, and then they ask them to improvise.
fMRI.
fMRI.
You really slur that. Just for those of us who are older who need a little slower,
fMRI, yes. No, functional magnetic resonance imaging.
There you go.
And what these scientists found is that these jazz pianists, before they engage in the act of improv, they turn off a part of the brain called the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. It's this part of the brain just behind the forehead. And this is a part of the brain it's a pretty useful part of the brain. It allows us to not eat all the ice cream in the fridge, to not say the first thing that comes to our mind. It allows us to exert self-control. But when you need to improvise, that's a voice telling you, don't do that, don't play that note, that's gonna sound bad. And you need to turn that voice off. And so what's amazing is these jazz pianists, over years of practice, have learned to inhibit their inhibitions. They have learned to silence that voice telling them no, no, no.
Do you know how?
It just takes practice. I mean, you know, in a sense, I think one of the paradoxes of these acts of improv is that it looks so easy, right? But that's only because they work so hard. And so one of the metaphors a scientist uses is that it's a bit like learning a second language. That you have to put in, you know, thousands of hours of practice and memorize all the verb conjugation charts and all the adjectives and nouns and so on, with the sole goal of one day when you need to speak, it can just come out of you. You don't need to think about it at all.
I want to pick up on something that you actually talked about at the very beginning of our conversation here, and I'll read a little excerpt from your book to do so. Creativity, you write, is not magic, and there's no such thing as a creative type. Creativity is not a trait that we inherit in our genes or a blessing bestowed by the angels. It's a skill. Anyone can learn to be creative and to get better at it. New research is shedding light on what allows people to develop world-changing products and to solve the toughest problems. A surprisingly concrete set of lessons has emerged about what creativity is and how to spark it in ourselves and our work. So let's hit this right on the head. Anybody can be creative?
Absolutely. We are all creative right now.
Anybody.
Anybody. Creativity is it's a defining feature of human nature, something that sets us apart from everything else.
Because surely you know way more people who are not creative than who are.
I know lots of people who think they're not creative. But this is because they've absorbed the myth that creativity is somehow very, very rare. Now, it is important to be clear. Not everyone's going to be Bob Dylan. Not everyone's going to be Pablo Picasso or Albert Einstein. Creativity is like any other skill. It is not evenly distributed. And yet it's something we can all learn to get better at. And I think the very first step is to realize that it's something we all have.
You mentioned earlier that the education system in some way reinforces this notion that it's only the truly brilliant who are creative. How do we reverse that?
It's not easy. I mean, I think the first step is to realize that we live in this day and age which assumes, you know, the only useful way to think is to be focused, to be very attentive. And so one of the first lessons we teach kids is stop daydreaming, stop looking out the window, stare straight ahead at the blackboard. And that's often bad advice that, you know, as we talked about earlier, daydreaming is a really useful mental state. People who daydream more score much higher in tests of creativity.
What about the schools? Who's going to tell the school system that the way we've been doing it for 120 years is wrong?
It's not easy, and it's going to take lots of work. I mean, I think some of the lowest hanging fruit, some of the first steps we should take are to really focus on this crucial window, third, fourth, and fifth grade. This is often known as the fourth grade slump. It's when a lot of kids decide they are not creative. And I think we really have to mount interventions there to tell these kids, you know what, your drawing may not live up to your standards now. Your painting may not be as beautiful as you'd like right now. But if you put in the work, you can get better at it. If you develop the talent. So there's a great scientist named Angela Duckworth. She's a psychologist at Penn who studies grit. It's a psychological trait that is basically about perseverance and persistence, the willingness to just stick with it no matter how hard or unfun it is. And she's got this wonderful advice for how to build grit and creativity in students, which is choose easy, work hard. That we have to expose our kids to a menu of possibilities early on. So let them fall in love with something. Maybe it's painting or drawing or computer programming or a sport. Let them fall in love with something that feels like play, not like work. And then once they commit to that, once they find that thing that feels easy and feels fun, you have to remind them again and again, work hard. It's not going to be easy. You're going to have to put in your 10,000 hours of practice, plus or minus 5,000 hours. You're going to have to commit to this. That's what it takes.
Having said that, the Einsteins, the Picassos,
who
was the other one you said? You said three
of them.
Bob
Dylan.
Bob Dylan, right. What percentage of the population has that potential of creativity?
It's unclear. I mean, genius remains one of these huge scientific mysteries. We don't even know how to define genius at this point. I mean, genius remains one of those things. It's a bit like porn. You know it when you see it. But it's very tough to scientifically figure out what makes them different from you or I, because you can give these geniuses a battery of cognitive tests, and it turns out they won't be smarter than the rest of us. They'll have perfectly ordinary IQ scores, and you can give them all sorts of personality tests, Myers-Briggs and all the rest, and once again, they'll look pretty ordinary. They may be a little bit more open to experience, but that's about it. So at the moment, we don't know what sets apart Bob Dylan and Pablo Picasso and Steve Jobs and Einstein from the rest of us. There is some indication There's some suggestive evidence that they are grittier than the rest of us. They are more persistent. They simply refuse to quit. I'm thinking here of someone like J.K. Rowling, who suffered through 12 rejections from publishers but kept on writing about that boy wizard in coffee shops while her baby daughter napped. So that is, you know, if you had to pick out one single theme among these highly successful creative people, it would be sheer persistence. They are simply grittier than the rest of us. They refuse to quit.
Persistence, yes. What about misery? You sometimes wonder whether or not people who've led too happy, too balanced, nice lives don't have it in them. Yeah. Because, you know, challenges, misery, difficulty, all of that, doesn't that contribute to it?
Well, one of the pieces of research that really surprised me in the book was that there is increasing evidence that these negative moods, being a little, you know, being a little miserable, a little melancholy, actually comes with some surprising mental perks. So people who are sad, and you can induce sadness in the lab pretty quickly by, you know, showing people a short video about death and cancer, or by asking undergraduates to recite their hopes and dreams, then telling them all the reasons those hopes and dreams will never happen. So you can kind of crush their spirit like that. And what you find is that people who are sadder, people who are, you know, in this melancholy frame of mind, that they are more persistent. So they write better essays, they make better collages, simply because they're more willing to stick with the problem, that they're more attentive, more vigilant. So this is not saying that you always want to be sad, because other studies show that when you are happy, whether it's because you've just had a beer or two, or because, you know, someone showed you a short video of Robin Williams doing stand-up, that leads to a 20% boost in having these moments of insight in these creative problems, creative problem-solving tasks. But you know, I think we always want to be happy. We assume it's always better to be happy. And there's a reason sometimes we're sad, too. That sadness comes with benefits as well.
It does have its payoff, doesn't it?
It does.
Yeah. Joan, it's awfully good of you to spend so much time with us here at TVO. The name of the book is Imagine How Creativity Works. Great read. Jonah Lehrer, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at TVO.org.